Okay, so maybe we can start. Okay, so in the last lecture, in the last two lectures actually, we saw an equivalence result at the level of calculus. I mean, two different ways to define a gradient and their equivalence. Now, in this lecture, and I think in the first hour, we will be speaking about another important fundamental equivalence result, which is equivalence of heat flows. Particularly viewed as gradient flows. Okay, so, and of course I will spend some time explaining what we mean by gradient flow in different situations. A more precise statement is that the L2 gradient flow of the Cheeger energy, okay, so this is the standard object that we already considered in the first lectures to prove the equivalence theorem at the level of Sobolev spaces, coincides with the W2 gradient flow of the entropy. Okay, this second part sounds a bit more mysterious because I have to explain what I mean by gradient flow of the entropy in a metric space, yes, which is the space of probability measures. And of course, to compare these two gradient flows, you should stay in a common domain for the two, and the common domain is the class of non-negative functions with integral 1, right? It is clear that if you identify these functions with measures, viewing f as a probability density, then you can look at the evolution problem in L2 or the evolution problem in the space of probability measures. And the final result is that the two are the same under some additional assumption. Okay. And to explain this, I will really start with the basic result, which actually motivated also the boom of optimal transportation, which is a result in 1998 by Jordan, Kinderlehrer, Otto. So they've been the first to realize that there is this connection in Rn. So I will start heuristically explaining why there is this connection in Rn for the standard heat equation. And then, of course, we will try to make things more precise and more abstract in general metric spaces. So from now on, let's say we are in Rn. Okay, so in Rn, of course, we have all the differentiable calculus, the standard differentiable calculus that we can use. And the leading idea is to make P of Rn as a kind of, first as a differentiable manifold, and then the next step is to turn it into a kind of Riemannian manifold. I'm using quotes here because none of these things is rigorous. So it will not be a differentiable manifold in the standard sense of differentiable geometry, so not really local coordinates. not even a Riemannian manifold. However, this heuristic picture will be very important to understand what is going on. So let's start from the differentiable manifold structure. The differentiable manifold structure is again based on the continuity equation, which, as you have seen, appears many times. Okay, so this is just basic continuity equation. And then the idea is that we can consider P over N as a differentiable manifold, considering that there is this coupling between infinitesimal variations of the measure and the velocity. Okay, so if you stay at a point mu, so I want to describe the tangent space, I want to describe at least formally the tangent space to mu at the tangent space to P over N at the point mu, then I consider this or this as a tangent vector, and they are identified through the continuity equation. Okay? So in this sense, this provides to me a kind of differentiable structure. And then I can define a metric. So again, given two tangent vectors, I call delta mu, delta prime mu, these two tangent vectors, I define the metric to be the integral of v dot v prime in d mu, where v and v prime are the corresponding vectors associated by the continuity equation. Okay? And so you see this is a non-constant and non-flat metric because it depends on mu. It's not the standard L2 metric. Actually, to make a connection also with PDEs, it appears like in the theory of optimal maps that the best thing to do is to take gradients, right? The best thing to do in this picture is to take gradients. And if you're taking gradient, let's say if mu is equal as a density with respect to Lebesgue measure, the connection between velocity and variation of the dense variation tangent vectors is given by a PDE minus divergence or rho lambda phi equal to delta mu. Okay, so you are really solving an elliptic PDE, well, not uniformly elliptic because rho will go to zero somewhere, but let's say locally uniformly elliptic if rho is smooth PDE. And so the connection between the velocity is given by solving a PDE. Okay, and then let's try to see that if we use this differentiable structure and this Riemannian structure formally, the heat equation is precisely the gradient flow of the entropy. So let's say why. Oh, the entropy here, of course, I mean the entropy with respect to Lebesgue measure. We are in Rn and well, okay, so first of all, let us compute the differential of the entropy, right? So I want to compute the differential of the map rho, integral of rho, along delta mu, where mu is rho times Lebesgue measure, okay? Well, Okay, so this means that I have to take a solution to the continuity equation, right? So the variation of mu is coupled to mu by this equation, and I have to differentiate this along this solution. So I get that this is equal to 1 plus the logarithm of rho times delta mu. Okay? And now I use the fact that delta mu is, so here I'm really differentiating in the classical sense the entropy function. Now I use this identity. Sorry, here I get nabla o log rho. Times v rho dx. And you see that here we should not simplify, I mean, we could compute the gradient of the logarithm, but it's better to leave it in this way. And you see that according to this scalar product, so I have computed the action of the differential on delta mu, and it is given by this scalar product. This tells me that the gradient, to pass from the differential to the gradient, I need the metric. The gradient in the vastest sense of the entropy at mu is precisely given by this vector. Okay, so here I'm using not only the differentiable, but also the Riemannian structure to write this down. Okay, and then once I realize that the gradient of the entropy is the gradient of the logarithm of the density, what is a gradient flow now according to this structure? So if you have any functional f of mu, how can you write the gradient flow of f in this Riemannian structure? Well, you should write that dt mu plus divergence of vt mu t is equal to zero. This is the usual continuity equation. And then you should say that the velocity is for any time opposite to the Wasserstein gradient of your energy function. Okay? So this is a general way if you have not only the entropy but any functional measures, if you write the gradient flow, you should combine continuity equation, which is due to the differentiable structure, with this equation, which uses really the metric. Okay, now in the case of the entropy, I mean, if mu t is equal to rho t times Lebesgue measure, here you get precisely that the velocity is equal to gradient. Yeah, I think I made some mistake with the sign somewhere.
Here, no matter.
Right, here there is, here there was no minus sign. Perfect. And so here we get minus the gradient of the logarithm. So in the particular case, when if f is equal to the entropy, here you get minus gradient of the logarithm of rho. And then, of course, if you insert now this information here, you get precisely the heat equation, right? You get dt rho t equal to divergence on nabla log rho t times rho t, which is maybe a funny way to write the heat equation. It is a nonlinear way to write the heat equation, but it's precisely the way to understand that it is the gradient flow of the entropy with respect to this Riemannian metric. Okay. So this is really the formal point of view. And just also to make the connection with the rigorous theory, I just say briefly that the induced Riemannian, this is not so formal, a posteriori can be made rigorous, because the induced, whenever you define a metric, you can define the induced Riemannian metric, the induced Riemannian distance, just by minimizing the action. And the induced Riemannian distance on P over N is exactly the Wasserstein distance. That Guido introduced using optimal transportation, right? So this is a completely Riemannian and differentiable way to describe the optimal transportation problem. Okay, now my goal is to see why, to illustrate why the same ideas, well, not really the same, because here we used a lot of differentiable structure, why similar ideas can be applied in a general context and why they are useful. Okay, so first of all, I should explain the sentence, a gradient flow of the entropy in Px with respect to the Wasserstein distance. Okay, now we are back to a metric setting, and also P over N from the rigorous point of view is only a metric space, so how can we give a meaning to this statement? Well, here there is a very nice idea of De Giorgi, of course you will see that always the same ideas come into play. Again, here the idea is to use a sharp rate of energy dissipation. So let me first explain this idea in a Hilbert space. So I am in a Hilbert space, I have a functional phi, and I have the standard formulation of the gradient flow. And I want to find a way to formulate the gradient flow equation, which is a system, in this case, infinite dimensional, if H is infinite dimensional. I would like to describe this using only the metric structure and not the differentiable structure. How can I do this? Well, the idea, again, is to look to minus the derivative of phi of y of t along a generic trajectory y. Well, by chain rule, this is equal to gradient phi of y prime, and then you can always bound this from above. You can always bound this from above with nabla phi of y prime. Okay, so let's say. Let me put a minus here. And so here I have equality. Let me emphasize the case of equality here. We have equality if and only if y prime is parallel to minus gradient of phi at y. Right? And then eventually I can apply the Young inequality between these two positive numbers, and I write it so you recognize in some sense the scheme that we already used yesterday, but we apply this scheme in a different context. I apply the Young inequality and then again here I have equality if and only if the modulus of the velocity is equal to the modulus of the gradient. Okay, so this is true for any curve y. So for any curve, minus the energy dissipation is bounded from above by this sum of squares. Let's say that what happens if we impose that along our curve, the energy dissipation rate minus the energy dissipation rate is maximal. If we impose that it is maximal, I mean it is given by this quantity, then we are saying at the same time that we have equality here and equality here. And so we are encoding the fact that the modulo of the two vectors are equal and that they are parallel. And so we are saying that this equation is true. Okay? So in this way, we encode into a single inequality, which is an energy dissipation inequality, a sharp energy dissipation inequality, the whole system. Okay, so now let me write down this in a metric space. Well, I will go instead of a pointwise formulation, an integral formulation. So I say that y of t, x of t is a gradient flow of phi with respect to d, with respect to a distance d, of course, if, well, first of all, well, I should say that x belongs to the domain of phi. And is locally absolutely continuous. I'm writing this in an integral form, so I say that the energy for any positive time t, the energy at time t plus the energy dissipation but as I said, I write the energy dissipation in this form. And here you see I'm using the descending slope because I want the gradient flow to stop at minimum points. dr is less than the energy at time zero. Let's say the energy at time zero. And you see this is a totally metric formulation of the problem because here I'm using the metric derivative, here I'm using the slope. A posteriori, this is equivalent if you are in a smooth setting to the ODE formulation. Okay, so in this way we can give a precise meaning to the notion of gradient flow of the entropy. So you just take phi equal to the entropy. And, well, okay, here I should maybe have called y. And distance. Okay, and so now let's see what is the connection between. Let me give you the idea of why L2 gradient flows are Wasserstein gradient flows. We need an assumption. Under the assumption, that the entropy, the slope of the entropy, is lower semi-continuous. There is a technical assumption which we will see is satisfied whenever you have a curvature condition. This assumption is satisfied. Okay, so if here I will not detail this part, the lower semi-continuity of the entropy is the ingredient which leads you to the equality between Fisher information and slope of the entropy. Okay, yesterday I observed that in general one has only an inequality, also because this might be trivial in some situations, and the lower semi-continuity of the entropy is the one which guarantees that there is actually equality here, and so also that this object is not trivial. And under this condition, okay, let's say what can we do? We know precisely the energy dissipation rate in this case. So we know that minus d over dt of the entropy, Ftm, remember, we computed this using the Eulerian calculus. Okay, in our case we know exactly what it is, so we need only to show that these two objects are related to the energy dissipation. And basically, you see, we have already one piece, which is this one. So the slope of the entropy, I stated that it is equal to the Fisher. And so I need only to know, to conclude, we only need that the metric derivative is less than squared, is less than, again, Fisher information. Okay, but this again was Kuwada lemma. If you remember, this was precisely the Kuwada lemma which we proved yesterday. So putting together this and this, you have that L2 gradient flows are Wasserstein gradient flows. In particular, you have an existence result for Wasserstein gradient flows. Okay, to show that they coincide, one needs a uniqueness theorem at the Wasserstein level. Okay? Because we already know that L2 gradient flows are unique just by the theory of maximal monotone operator. But we have embedded these gradient flows in a larger class of gradient flows, a priori larger. If you are able to show that the larger class is also has uniqueness, then of course the two flows should coincide. Okay? And it is precisely here that the curvature conditions start really to play an important role. So now I really start to introduce what I already presented in the first lecture, the CDK infinity assumption and its analytic implications. So C D K infinity. Okay, so we say that CDK infinity holds. If for any mu 0, mu 1 in the domain of the entropy, so if you take any two measures with finite entropy, then there exists a geodesic such that you have the convexity inequality, actually a K convexity inequality, plus T mu 1, and here there is a modulus of continuity minus K over 2 times the square distance. Okay, maybe now in some statements to simplify I will put k equals 0, but this is just the general definition. Okay, so let me just emphasize an important technical point. Here we're just saying existence. There is some geodesic. What happens if we put the condition that this is true for any geodesic, right? If we, a priori, we impose a stronger definition. Well, then you still have a strong consistency, because in the Riemannian case, geodesics are unique, right? But a priori, the problem is that you lose stability. Because, you know, when you take a limit of spaces, to show that for the limit space you have the convexity inequality, what you typically do is to try to approximate a geodesic in your limit space by geodesics in the approximating spaces. And a priori, there might be in the limit space geodesics which are not reachable by approximation. So the only, apparently for the moment, the only way to get a stable condition is to put a weaker condition, an existence quantifier. Okay, so what are analytic implications of CDK infinity? Well, basically, all these things now will come from the typical monotonicity properties of convex of differential quotients of convex functions. So the most important ones are that duality formula. For the slope. The duality formula for the slope. So in general, the slope is a supremum, a lean sup. But you can use convexity to show that this lean sup is a supremum. And this is the supremum. Minus the entropy on nu. And here there is now a correction due to K. Minus K, K negative part of K over 2. Divided identify the vastest end distance between you and me. And here you can take also the positive part. Okay, and for instance, in the case k equals 0, you see, I simply replace the lean soup by a soup. The lean soup which defines the negative slope, the descending slope. Okay, this is a simple convexity argument. And out of this, this implies that the slope is lower semi-continuous. Is lower semi-continuous. Why? Because I have written the slope as a supremum of functionals indexed by nu. Each one of these functionals is lower semi-continuous with respect to mu. So all lower semi-continuous with respect to mu, keeping nu fixed. This is easy because the entropy is lower semi-continuous, this is continuous, this is continuous. And so, remember, this assumption played a role in the agreement between the slope of the entropy. So we know that in our case, this is really the Fisher information. Another important property is the which I think we will use a little bit later on, is the upper gradient property. Maybe I write this here. Remember, I already introduced the upper gradient property in yesterday. We can say that the negative part, the descending slope, is an upper gradient. For the entropy. So explicitly this means that you can estimate the difference of the entropy between two measures you can estimate by the integral of the slope dt. Okay, remember this was our definition of slope of n of upper gradient in a metric space. Well, this is a non-trivial property because, I mean, it will be easy to check if for Lipschitz functions, but of course this is a convex function, can be very discontinuous. So the verification of this property is not trivial. Let me just give you a quick sketch of the proof. I mean, the idea is that you can use this property to prove a kind of one-sided and local, and now I will explain what I mean by one-sided and local Lipschitz estimate. Okay, let me simplify. In fact, I already erased the additional part. Let me state this for k equals 0. Right? For k equals 0, this is the formula for the... okay, so in particular, what you get? You get that you can always bound the entropy at mu minus the entropy at nu by this formula. With the distance between mu and nu times the slope of the entropy at one of the two points, precisely at mu. And so you see that you might consider this as a kind of one-sided, because you don't have the modulus here, and local, because you have a you don't have a constant in front of the distance, Lipschitz estimate. And it's a surprising fact that, however, out of this one-sided and local Lipschitz estimate, you really, again, you can get that it is absolutely continuous, the entropy along any absolutely continuous curve, and you get the inequality with the modulus. This is a non-trivial fact. it's a calculus lemma in one variable. Okay. Okay, I think now we have all the ingredients to obtain this theorem, which is precisely the uniqueness theorem that we needed at the Wasserstein level. This is a result obtained by Nicola Gigli 3 years ago. Which says that under the CDK infinity condition, unique. As a consequence, we know that the two classes of gradient flows coincide. Okay. And actually, this is an interesting case of uniqueness without contractivity, and I will explain this after giving the proof. So in the Hilbertian theory of gradient flows on maximal monotone operators that we saw in the first day, we had at the same time uniqueness. Uniqueness came out of a contractivity property, right? Here, this is a case where we are able to get uniqueness even if we don't have, in general, contractivity. Okay, so how the proof works? It's a convexity argument. Okay, so the proof uses the following ingredients. Well, first of all, this you can check by exercise. This map is jointly convex. Convex in the standard sense, not in the geodesic sense. This is jointly convex in PM, class PM. I mean, convex in the sense of standard convex structure of PM as an affine subspace of the space of measures. So this is convex. This is a first ingredient. And this implies, in particular, by differentiation, this implies, in particular, that the metric derivative of a convex combination so if you take a convex combination of two curves, and you do the metric derivative of this convex combination squared, this is convex. I mean, you have to take the squares because convexity here is at the level of the squared distance. This is the first property. X.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. And the second convexity property, which I think is well known, is that this just comes from the strict convexity of the entropy function. This is strictly convex. And I think I don't need anything else. Ah, no, I need also, well, this is also non-trivial, but the slope also is convex. Is convex. And finally, I will use also the upper gradient property. So I need these three convexity property, and for one of them, I have strict convexity plus the upper gradient property. Okay, so let's take two solutions. Both starting from mu bar. And I write the energy dissipation inequality, which is the George's definition, so the entropy of mu I t, say for any positive time t, is less than the entropy at the initial time. Okay? And now I do the convex combination of the two. So maybe I will call this mu t. And I know that at the level of convex combination, everything improves because I have a convexity. And actually, strictly improves as soon as, for some t, these two measures are different, right? And so I get that the entropy of mu t, for sufficiently large t, as soon as I find the t for which they are different, minus of the entropy of mu t square dt is strictly less than the entropy of mu bar. Okay? And here I use the strict convexity of the entropy. Well, how I reach the contradiction? Here, the heuristic idea is that, in some sense, this energy dissipation rate is maximal. So, in some sense, I have found a solution whose energy dissipation rate is too large. A curve for which the energy dissipation rate is too large. How I can make this rigorous? Now I applied the upper gradient property, and this is where the CDK assumption plays an important role. By the upper gradient property, this is less than the entropy of mu t plus the integral between 0 and t of mu t prime dt. Okay. So here I really needed the upper gradient property. Okay, and then eventually you simplify the extreme, the entropy term here, and you get that this integral is strictly smaller than this integral, which is not possible. Okay? And so we get a contradiction. And so this means that the gradient flow is unique. Why I am saying that this is an interesting case of uniqueness without contractivity? Well, because if you are in a sufficiently nice setting, you can really compute more or less explicitly all these objects, and so you can make an asymptotic analysis. This was done by Ota and Sturm. So Ota and Sturm made many papers on Finsler spaces. In particular, let's say that we consider Rn with a norm and with Lebesgue measure, okay? So this will be my M. And then what they proved is that the gradient flow, the heat flow, so now we know that there is a unique heat flow, and I say heat flow can be understood in any sense. The heat flow is contractive, is W2 contractive, if and only if this norm is Hilbertian. So it comes from a scalar product. Okay. So in general, even in this simple situation, we have uniqueness of the gradient flow, but you will never have contractivity unless you are Hilbertian. Okay, and we will see in the second part, in the last part of my lecture, where also this assumption plays a role in proving contractivity also in general metric spaces. So already in light of this result, you start to see that this is an important assumption, which of course translates into the fact that the Cheeger energy is quadratic. Or translates into the fact that the heat flow is linear. So in this setting, all these things are equivalent, okay? Very well. And okay, I think maybe this is a good place to stop for 15 minutes, and then we go a little beyond the CDK infinity theory. So in the last hour, I can really reach the latest papers that I announced in the introductory lecture. So now we can really speak about Riemannian spaces with curvature bounded from below, with Ricci curvature. So I think I will not have time, or maybe very little time at the end, to speak about the dimensional theory. So I will just assume n equal to infinity, which means does not mean that the spaces are really infinite dimensional. They could be. Only means that we are not putting any upper bound on the dimension. Okay. So we speak only about CDK infinity. So lower bound on curvature, no lower bound on the dimension, and we added an R to remind that we have a stronger definition, a Riemannian definition. And the basic result of my paper with Gillian Savare, my second paper with Gillian Savare, is this, that the following three conditions are equivalent. Pardon?
Are there differences in looking at the theorem or different cardinalities of the infinity of the dimension, or if I look at other one or higher?
You mean on the real line? No, the, sorry.
No, your main dimension is infinity. But
yeah, no, I'm. No. In fact, it's a bit misleading because n in this theory is a kind of upper bound on the dimension. So when you say n equal to infinity, you are saying I'm not putting any upper bound on the dimension. So I mean, for instance, that you can safely say that Rn is CD0 infinity. Of course, this is not a very precise description because you already know that n has finite dimension. But you are simply neglecting... you are not considering for the moment any upper bound on the dimension, right? In fact, the more precise information, but I don't know if I will have time to reach this, is that this space is CD0n, right? But, okay. Yeah, anyhow, one should not think that all these spaces are necessarily infinite dimension. Right. Equivalent? Well, first of all, we are enforcing the CDK infinity condition. So we say that it is CDK infinity and the heat flow is linear. But as I said, this equivalence between 1 and 2 is really easy. It's a consequence of previous results. You could say that, let's say the L2 gradient, okay, let me write in this way, L2 gradient flow of the Cheeger energy. Is linear, or you could say, as we said, that the Wasserstein gradient flow of the Cheeger energy is additive. We can't really say linear because we are on an affine subspace, but we can say that it is additive. And the equivalence between these two facts is clear because we proved that these two objects are the same in their common domain. Pardon? Oh, sorry. Yeah, right. Entropy. While the really new condition, which is equivalent to either one or two, and I need to explain, is that any mu bar in P of X is the starting point of an EVIK solution, EVIK gradient flow. Of the entropy. Okay, so this third characterization calls for a new definition of gradient flow, stronger than the previous ones, which is the EVI, the notion of EVI gradient flows. And before I go through the definition of EVI, I explain why, in some sense, we need this additional condition, right? Well, we should keep in mind that our goals are always to keep consistency. to retain, so we are doing a stronger axiomatization. We want to keep consistency and stability. Otherwise, in some sense, this theory is useless, okay? Okay, what happens if we add that the Cheeger energy is linear? It's clearly still consistent with the Riemannian case, right? But stability is extremely difficult to show using only, I mean, we know that by itself, taken alone, the CDK infinity condition is stable, but the combination of CDK infinity and the linearity of the Cheeger energy is by no means elementary. So at least we don't know any proof which does not use property 3. And maybe some of you know that there are, also from the point of view of calculus of variation, gamma convergence, there are examples of limits of Riemannian metrics which are not Riemannian, right? For instance, in homogenization. So it's very easy to lose the quadratic structure when you take limits. And so, I mean, this is a non-trivial fact. The fact that the combination of the two is still stable, so we still have a good theory, is precisely due to this additional characterization. And now we spend a little time explaining what is the notion of EVI. Okay, again, I can go back to the Hilbertian framework. I am in a Hilbert space. I am considering the solution okay, the notion of EVI goes back, at least was strongly inspired by some work of Benny Lang in the 70s. Okay, what can we do also? We can write the subdifferential inequality. Yeah, here it is more convenient to write this in terms of a subdifferential inequality. Subdifferential inclusion. In fact, this theory applies to convex functionals. So the EVI theory, in some sense, is designed for convex energies. So let me start from this. And I can write this differential inclusion in this way, that phi of y minus phi of xt is always greater than so minus x prime is in the subdifferential, so is minus x prime of t y minus x of t. Let's say for any t and for any y. Okay, let me assume that the curve is differentiable everywhere just to motivate this definition. Okay, but now the point. So phi convex. Okay, now the point is that I can write, however, this as the time derivative of 1/2 xt minus y squared. And you see that if I say that phi of y minus phi of xt is always greater than this derivative, I'm using only, like in the Georgi definition, only the energy and the distance. And so I say that, let's say, in a metric space, y dy, an absolutely continuous curve, y, let's say, in AC2 lock, y is an EVI solution. Okay, now I will put it into also the parameter k. I mean, in this inequality, k was equal to 0. And in general, you have an additional term. If the time derivative 1 over 2 distance y square yt z plus phi of yt is always less than phi on z. So you have a kind of test. You have to test the derivative. Is like in the Alexandro theory, right? You have to test the time, in this case, the time derivative, while in the Alexandro theory you are testing the convexity properties. You have to test the time derivative of the square distance from a generic point z. And you want that this derivative plus the energy at time t should be less than phi at time z, of the test point z. Okay. Ah, and I forgot here there is, I should add the k dependence is plus, here you should add the k over 2, when you have a k convexity, I mean if phi is k convex, here you should add k over 2, so the derivative plus phi plus k over 2 d square of y is less than phi of z. Okay. Well, a few words about this notion. This is AVI is much stronger than the gradient flow based on energy dissipation. So for instance, just to illustrate to you the strength of this condition, I will show you how EVI implies contractivity again, which means that in the situation we were before, for instance of a non-Hilbertian norm, there is no possibility to get an EVI solution. So whenever you have EVI solutions, they are always contractive. And so this means that this notion of gradient flow is stronger than the one based only on energy dissipation. For instance, let's say that you have two solutions, y1 and y2, EVI, let me put k equals 0. And maybe I just give a sketch of the proof omitting some technical details. So you know that the time derivative of 1 half of y1t z is less than phi of z minus phi of y1t. Okay? This is the EVI for y1. But then you have also the EVI, this is a kind of argument which comes also from the theory of conservation laws, it's a kind of Kruskov scheme. Y2 of t. And then the idea is, which can be made rigorous, even if you have inequalities for almost every time, is to take z equal to y2 here, and w equal to y1 here, okay? And then you add the two inequalities. T y2t. So by Leibniz rule, you know this is the sum of the two partial derivatives. Plus plus 1 half d over ds 1 half s equal t, and then to estimate these two partial derivatives you use precisely the EVI information, and you get that this is non-negative. So this is a formal proof, but it can be made rigorous. And so you have contractivity for free. And I mean, this property has a very strong implications. So EVI implies, as we saw, contractivity. It implies also stability, as I said. It is quite easy to show that this notion of gradient flow is stable. And this is much less elementary. This is this was proved by Daneri and Savare. This implies convexity along, or let's say, k-convexity along all geodesics. And you see, this is an extremely interesting fact because as I explained at the beginning of today's lecture, there is no reason why, no abstract reason why by itself convexity along all geodesics should be a stable condition, because there might be in the limit geodesics which are not reachable and so on. And it is surprising the fact that you can find a stronger property, which is the EVI, which is stable and implies this a priori unstable condition. Okay, and now I will give some ideas about how we can connect conditions 1 and 2 to 3. And this is where really all the calculus that I explained in my first lecture plays a role. More precisely, I will explain how one can pass from 1 or 2 to 3. So how we can try to derive the EVI property assuming at the same time convexity and quadratic structure of the Cheeger energy. Okay, so the scheme of the proof is this. There are two ingredients, one which is elementary, as we will see, which is the derivative of Wasserstein distance along absolutely continuous course. Okay, in the AVI formulation, it appears the derivative of this object, so we really have to compute it. And this is the more elementary ingredient. The really non-trivial one is the derivative of the entropy. Along geodesics. Okay, so let me explain the two. So we have my curve in the space of measures. I have my test measure, which I call nu. Remember that in the EVI formulation there is a test point to be used. And I consider the optimal transport problem between mu t and z. Associated to this problem, as you have seen in Guido's lecture, there is a Kantorovich potential. Which I recall is defined in this way, that W22 or mu t nu is equal to the integral. I hope I'm following more or less the same conventions of Guido. Plus the integral of phi of the C transform of phi t d nu. Okay, so for any t, I have a maximizer in the dual formulation, which I call phi t, Kantorovich potential. Okay, now using this, I can really compute at least the first part, the derivative of the Wasserstein distance. And here the observation is that since phi t plus phi tc, by definition, is less than c. Of course, here my c is the distance square. I know that W22 mu t plus h nu is always larger. Because I am in the dual formulation, is always larger than the integral on x of phi t d mu t plus h plus the integral of phi t c d nu. Okay? And so this means that at points where this distance is differentiable, and it is differentiable at any point, I can compute the derivative of this function knowing the derivative of this function, right? It's the usual comparison argument which appeared also in the proof of McCann theorem, for instance. And so this means that the time derivative, for almost every t, the time derivative is equal to the time derivative of this, but we know what is this derivative because of mu t solving the heat equation. Okay, maybe now I will start to call mu t equal to rho t times m. Dm. Okay, and now I will write it in this form. I mean, I'm just using the usual integration by parts formula. I can write this as less than the liminf, or the limit, as epsilon goes to zero, of the Cheeger energy of rho t minus epsilon phi t minus the Cheeger energy of rho t divided by 2 epsilon. Okay, so roughly speaking, what I'm computing here, you see, the Laplacian is non-linear a priori in rho, but this expression is linear in phi. So the expression I have here is basically is the differential of the Cheeger energy at the point rho t, or rho t m, along the direction phi t, right? The differential should be linear. Okay. Pardon? Yeah, this is based on the integration by parts formula. Okay, so let me. You remember that there was an inequality between minus. Okay, let me see if I can reconstruct this. There was an inequality between minus phi delta rho dm was always larger than d phi star d rho star, right? This was the integration by parts formula. Dm, and this is smaller. Actually, it is by convexity, I think you can check that this is smaller than this one, if I remember well. Well, if you assume that the Cigar energy is quadratic, it's clear, right? But okay, I think here there is a you have really no, maybe you should not apply the integration by parts formula, but you should really revisit. No, this is the definition of subdifferential, right? You apply the definition of subdifferential. Minus delta rho is in the subdifferential. So you see, you can bound this difference by, you see what I mean? Just applying the definition of subdifferential. Okay, let's apply the definition of subdifferential. Is greater than minus delta rho, because this is the element in the subdifferential. Times minus epsilon phi right, and then you divide by epsilon. There is a two somewhere. Now maybe the normalization, depends on, the Cigar energy was normalized with the factor 1 over 2, so there is no 2 here. Okay, so you get this expression. I'm not using yet the assumption that the Cigar energy quadratic. I want really to emphasize the point where this assumption comes into play. Okay, maybe I will assume k equals 0, also still to simplify some computation. Well, the non-trivial fact is that, let me go back now to this picture I was doing before. I'm taking now the geodesic. Maybe I will call this geodesic mu st, right? Mu st will be the geodesic from mu t to nu, so the index s will run between 0 and 1, while t will be just the time parameter in the heat flow. And the second ingredient is that the derivative of the entropy along the geodesic, so basically you prove this property, you prove it for any fixed time. The time t plays no role in this proof. It's just a geometric formula of the derivative of the entropy along geodesics. S. This is larger than another limit. which is the limit as epsilon goes to zero of the Cheeger energy of phi t minus the Cheeger energy of phi t plus epsilon ft rho t divided by epsilon. And so you see that, well, I will not have time to explain where this formula comes from. It really uses the calculus that I described in my first lectures. More or less, you see, we already computed with this calculus some difference quotient of the entropy. So more or less, the ideas are already appeared in my lectures on how to compute, estimate the difference quotients of the entropy using optimal transport. Here, I just want to emphasize the difference between this term and this term, because this is, again, a kind of, you can view this as the differential of the Cheeger energy, but now at the point phi t along the direction, and there is a minus again, along the direction rho t. And so, in general, there is no reason, if you are in a non-Riemannian framework, if your norm is not Hilbertian, this object, a priori, has nothing to do with this object. Right? Because the rows are inverted. But if you are quadratic, they are the same. So, the Cheeger energy quadratic implies that they are the same. And precisely because they are the same, I can prove the EVI property. Let's see why, combining these two facts, we get the EVI property. Okay. So since this is equal to this, I can say that this is smaller than this one. But then now it's a matter of convexity. I mean, if for a convex function, again, I have the monotonicity of difference quotients along geodesics, this is the right derivative at time zero, which is occurred is less than the difference quotient at time one, which is the entropy of m at nu minus the entropy of m at mu t. And so you see that I have got precisely the EVI property, derivative of the distance squared less than this. And so this proves in one direction why 1 and 2 imply the EVI property. Okay, maybe just a few words to conclude, and maybe I will leave some time for questions. Remember the Bakri-Emery condition. The Bakri-Emery condition, which I also introduced in my very first lecture, is an inequality between the Laplacian, and now all these objects you see are well defined in our framework, minus. Okay, then I have to tell you what is now this object instead. Okay, so the question is, can we write the Bakri-Emery condition in our framework? Is it true? Does it hold? this is the other side of the theory of Ricci lower bounds. Well, to do this, all these objects are well defined, the Laplacian. I have to tell you what is this now. And this is defined as follows. There is, not elementary result, which tells us that the formula so if the Cheeger energy is quadratic, the formula goes to zero. You remember, before we were looking at this derivative under the integral. So we were computing the derivative of the Cheeger energy. Now we are really trying to compute this derivative pointwise. There is no integral here. And this limit exists in L1. And defines a bilinear form, a continuous bilinear form in W12 times W12. So now we have a pointwise, or let's say almost everywhere defined pointwise object, let's say an L1 function. And of course, this object plays exactly the role of the scalar product between gradients, which is now, I emphasize again, is pointwise defined. And in the theory of Bakri-Emery, this is typically denoted by gamma, because for them it's a totally abstract object. So they use an abstract notation. Gamma fg plays the role of nabla f, nabla g. And so all these objects make sense in this theory. And one of our results is that theorem. In a RCD K infinity space, the Bakri-Emery condition holds. And informally, well, I will not give a technical statement. Let's say under suitable non-degeneracy assumption, let's say Cheeger quadratic, this is necessary, plus the Bakri-Emery condition imply RCD. Okay, so a posteriori we can really say that these are two sides of the same theory. Not exactly, because when I mention non-degeneracy assumption, you know, the problem are, as usual, these examples of spaces for which the Cheeger energy is identically zero, right? Of course, if the Cheeger energy is identically zero, then all this object becomes trivial, and also the Bakri-Emery condition is trivially true. So you can't expect to get any geometric implication on your space. So you should add some kind of mild non-degeneracy condition, like, for instance, for the semigroup, you should add the Feller regularizing condition, and then you are able to restore the validity of the implication. Okay, this is our third paper where we basically prove that the two sides of the theory are equivalent. Maybe just a few words about what about the dimensional theory? This is much more technical and still not completely understood. I just say in a few words what is the main difference. The main difference, one of the main differences, is that to put the dimension into play, you should not work with the standard entropy, the Boltzmann-Shannon entropy, but you have to use a dimensional entropy. So an entropy which depends on the dimension, which is called Rényi entropy, which is this minus the integral of rho dm. And again, you start to ask convexity for this, for k equals 0, Cd0n means precisely that this energy is convex along geodesics. For k different from 0, things become extremely more complicated. And actually, it is maybe nicer to write the Rényi entropy adding a constant term, of course, which does not affect the convexity properties. If you write the Rényi entropy in this way, minus the integral of rho minus rho dm, and you multiply by n, and if you scale, of course, this has no effect on the convexity properties because you are adding a constant, you are multiplying by a constant. But you see that the formal limit also in a rigorous sense, as n goes to infinity, is really. So in this way, you have a really kind of consistence theory, which in the limit as n goes to infinity gives you the CDK infinity theory. Okay? And, well, on the course, in very recent papers, so basically of this year, the RCD-KN theory started to be developed. So RCD, roughly speaking, again means that you add to this condition that the Cheeger energy is quadratic, between quotes, because there are here many subtle aspects to be investigated. And on this, and then of course again you can ask what is the connection with the Bakri-Emery theory. And there is a first very nice result by Erbar, Kuvada, and Sturm. And there is also a work in progress I have with Andrea Mondino and Giuseppe Savarin. But this is really recent theory, I mean, and as I said, not yet completely understood. Okay, so I think it's a good idea to stop a few minutes before so that if you have questions, you are welcome. Thank you.